Good morning, everybody. Today we're going to talk a little bit more about forgiveness and why it's important that we forgive other people. And the ultimate example to remember is that while we were still wretched sinners and some people even worse than us, God forgave us. You know, we have the ability to come to the cross and he extends his grace to us. So I think it's good that we dwell on that and we dwell on the perfect example of grace. And we should sing Amazing Grace because I love this song and I will never tire of its message and lyrics and melody. And I hope you don't either. So, you are forever mine.
unending love, amazing grace, and freely, freely you have received. So freely, freely give. Welcome, everyone. Welcome. And I hope that you feel that unending love, that amazing grace this morning that's freely given to you, so that you get nourished and encouraged and strengthened enough to go out of this building, out of this stained glass window, go out and freely give. Amen. Let us worship God.
My Lord, what love is this that pays so dearly that I, the guilty one, may go free? Amazing
together. Loving God, we are yours. We come as we are with our cares and concerns. We long to touch you and find healing in your embrace. Strengthen our faith and heal our brokenness that we may worship you with joy. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Last weekend, my son and his grandson Grady, they stayed with us for the weekend. Grady's birthday was in June, and he wished for Phillies baseball tickets. And so Dad came through, and the two guys went over to Philadelphia twice last weekend. It was Grady's first professional baseball game that he's ever attended. They live in the State College areas, I think I've told you before, and they're in between Pittsburgh and Philly. And so I think Dad's indoctrinated him to be a Phillies fan, so that's where they went. So two games, and on that Saturday game, if you recall, it was rain delayed. So here's a kid's first baseball game, and he's got to suffer through 5-6 hours of a baseball game to get to the end. The Phillies won, fortunately, 4-2. And then the next day, it was a trouncing. San Diego Padres beat up the Phillies 13-1 or some nonsense like that. But what I want to tell you about is that Eric, my son, and Grady, they decided to go down near the bullpen area of the stadium and, you know, check out the baseball game from that area. And at one point, my son allowed Grady to wander off, and you know, he kind of lost track of him. There's so many people at the game. So my son is freaking out. He's telling the ushers, you know, Grady's wearing a Belfont red T-shirt. Blah, blah. He, you know, 6 or 7 minutes, he doesn't know where his son is. And it's, as Eric said, it was like an eternity, that experience. So I just want to keep that in mind for you this week. There's a lot of Grady's out there in this community. A lot are distracted by all the lights and noise and fanfare of our world, and they're unaware that their father is desperately looking for them. So maybe this week you could tap somebody on the shoulder and remind them of their father that's looking for them and encourage them to come and find him here. Would you read with me the vision statement? We are a Christ-centered family of Christians. We are actively seeking to grow the kingdom of God by bringing the word and the love of God to the community. We may not always think alike, but we always love alike, as God has taught us. And now we'll hear from Ann Simpson.
Good morning. I'm in my kitchen today. Before we start with our chat, I want to ask you for some help. We could use a new name for Sunday school. So if you think of a new name for the children's Sunday school and for the teen Sunday school, could you please send it to the office so that we could have new school start in September with new names? And if yours is chosen, you're going to get a gift card from Chick-fil-A. So, doesn't that sound like a good deal? So, if you think of a new word, new slogan maybe, for teens and for our children, please send it to Linda in the office. Thanks. Now, for our chat today, as a teacher, there were many times when I needed to have children follow directions. And one of the ways that I did that, which was a fun way, was to ask them to write down the directions for making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You'd be surprised sometimes at how funny some of those directions became. But to make a peanut butter jelly sandwich, of course, you need bread, 2 slices of bread. And then we're going to have to spread that bread with peanut butter, of course. Then some people want jelly on top of the peanut butter, or do you put your jelly on the other slice of bread and smush the two together? Whichever way you do it, you can show somebody else how to do it too, following directions. In the Bible, the disciples spent a long time with Jesus, and Jesus sometimes would go off by himself and pray. And when he came back, one of his disciples said, "Lord, can you teach us to pray?" And this is what Jesus said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. He told them the Lord's Prayer. It's not a very long prayer, so it's easy to memorize. And the very first thing it does is it praises God, our Father in heaven. The second thing it does is it thanks God for giving us all our daily needs. And finally, it asks for forgiveness for when we fall short of what the behavior he expects of us. The Lord's Prayer has lasted for over 2,000 years. It gives me comfort, and I hope it does for you too. Have a very good week and enjoy your summer. Bye.
Hi, my name is Chris.
And I am Darlene Fitzgerald. And we welcome you to our church. Welcome to Audubon United Methodist Church.
Happy Sunday.
Thank you so much. Mark, you have a whole row of family sitting together. Wow, would you mind introducing your family to us? I'm sure we have met. Father, yeah. Yes. Welcome, everyone. Okay, why don't we give our Audubon welcome by giving them a big applause? So nice to have you all. I would like to invite Lois to the microphone today. You know, we have five vision teams. One of the five vision team is Kindness Committee. Committee begins with K instead of C. And Kindness Committee is focusing on caring acts, not only just for our church families, but for the community. And part of Acts 20 Now outreach efforts, Kindness Committee did very wonderful ministry for our community at this time.
Good morning. I just wanted to let everyone know the Kindness Committee, along with myself, Barbara Condras, Barbara Kinane, and Sue Madura, presented a lunch to the Audubon Police Department on this last Thursday. We thought it would be nice to honor them, even though we can't do it all at the same time because they work in shifts. We were able to bring the lunch over, and then they had it at their leisure. We gave them a hoagie tray, we gave them beverages, we gave them brownies. And I understand from the secretary that she had a go after one of the policemen who was hiding the brownies. But they were very appreciative. And Linda Halonia found a really nice verse that we put along and gave to each one of the policemen. Along with the lunch, thanks to the congregation, we presented 20 officers with $10 Wawa gift cards. They were all very appreciative and thanked us as much as they can. I also enclosed one of our cards from the Methodist Church, just in case they would like to visit us.
Oh, that's wonderful.
But thank you again for your donations.
Thank you so much, everyone. Lois referred to this invite card, and these cards are available in the basket out there. So please take some and share with people that it doesn't matter if you don't know them. Just say, you know, whatever, invite. And you are invited, something like that. All right, so Acts 29 Outreach Challenge this week is to remember to include those public workers in your prayers, police officers, everyone, even governors, politicians, including our president, include all those public workers in your prayers. Would you? Yeah, thank you. Let us pray. Lord of forgiveness, we are so grateful for all that you have done for us. Each day reminds us in many ways of your mercy and your love. Yet there are times in our lives when we have felt lost and alone. We have been hurt and frightened and wondered where you were. Remind us again of your loving presence. Place your hands of healing on our lives. Comfort us when we become afraid, lost, lonely, and fearful. Prepare us to serve you faithfully all our days. And we lift our dear ones to you, who are in need of your healing love. Be with them now, and with us also, in all the places and times of our lives. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh Lord, please hear my prayer. In the morning when I rise, is your servant bound for glory? Oh dear Lord, please hear.
We have two readings today, one in the Old Testament, which can be found in the book of Psalms, 103, verses 1 through 12. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquities? Who heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from the pit? Who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy? Who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like eagles? The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his way to Moses. He acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. And for the New Testament, reading is found in Matthew 18, verses 15 through 22. If another member of the church sins against you, go, point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on this earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you lose on this earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if you agree on earth about anything that you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or more are gathered in my name, I am there among them. And this is the amazing, not the good news, but this is the great news of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Matthew chapter 18. Verse 21, then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if my brother or sister sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. Last week, in continuing my sermon series on the Lord's Prayer, I looked at the first half of the petition, forgive us our trespasses, the divine side of the petition. Today, I will look at the second half of this petition, the words, as we forgive those who trespass against us, the human side. It is interesting to note in passing that in what is perhaps the most individual, personal moment of this prayer, the request for God's forgiveness for our failing. Even here, we are not allowed to make this prayer as solitary individuals, just as we were taught at the beginning to say, our Father, not my Father, just as this prayer looks forward to the coming of a kingdom, a community, an entirely new society. So here, our forgiveness from God is intimately related to our forgiveness of one another. This model for all prayers is insistently communal and persistently three-way conversation embracing God, myself, and our neighbor. Now back to forgiveness. And this morning, I want to concentrate on one simple question. One simple question. Why forgive? Why forgive? This question came to my mind as I was dealing with my own personal emotions about 3 years ago when my daughter Lydia's father suddenly died from heart attack. It was for me to forgive him for not caring for Lydia, his own daughter, all those years since she was 4 years old. So she had to grow up with the feeling of being abandoned by her father, whom she had missed dearly. And now that he's gone, there is no opportunity to reconcile with him. And Lydia had to face the harsh demands and respect, disrespect of her father's family, that is her family. Lydia refused to visit with them personally. My gut literally was ill after having to deal with them on behalf of Lydia. So, why forgive while they have not cared for a child whose father and his family were totally out of her life? And the family says to knock her heart feeling off. So the question, why forgive, became more personal to me. And of course, that was not the only incident that regarding the question of why forgive. And I'm sure you have many of them too. So, why forgive? On the most basic level, one might argue that we forgive because it is our duty, because our Lord Himself commanded it. Love your enemies, He urged. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who persecute you. While in the agony of death, He uttered up this unforgettable prayer. Forgive them, Father. Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. Therefore, as obedient followers of Christ, we must forgive. On the other hand, that old concept of duty, of faith, as unquestioning obedience, is under siege in our time. Christians today want to use their minds to understand such commandments before they accept them. And surely, that is not so bad. And another response to the question, why forgive, is found in the everyday realm of common sense. After all, it works out better all around. Bearing a grudge may be sort of snug and satisfying for a while, but it demands so much time and energy. Whereas forgiveness lends itself to a calmer, smoother life. The more enemies you have, the more potential you incur for conflict, controversy, not to mention lawyer's fees. Why not save yourself a lot of anguish by forgiving and forgetting? Forgiveness, in other words, cuts down on your anger budget. It diminishes those operating costs of resentment, bitterness, hatred, and the wastage of spirit involved in such transactions. So you forgive for your own sake, for your own peace and health. Yet, While this is true, it is just a bit too practical for me, too self-oriented. Surely forgiveness means more than cutting your emotional losses to promote mental health. I suspect that this kind of superficial self-help forgiveness often does not work, at least not for very long. A third motivation for forgiveness is that we forgive in order to be forgiven. Doesn't Jesus put it in such a way? For if you forgive folk their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will also forgive you. Yet, despite its traditional authority, I find this view also inadequate, also appealing to less than the best in our faith. It is still, when all is said and done, rather a selfish rationale. We forgive in order to gain something for ourselves. Not mental health this time, but something even more valuable. Eternal life, no less. And on God's side too, divine forgiveness becomes not an act of free grace, but a reward, a bargain, a business deal. Surely, Jesus did not mean that we can earn God's forgiveness by our own acts of forgiving. To probe a little deeper, perhaps, to the thinking of Jesus, might it be that we forgive not in order to be forgiven, but because we realize that we too need to be forgiven? We realize we too need forgiveness. That was why Jesus was so hard on the Pharisees, not because they were evil people. On the contrary, they were good, moral, and upright souls, the most moral folk of their day. Yet, precisely because of this goodness, they were blind to their own remaining fault, saw no necessity to be forgiven, and thus found it fatally easy to judge those whose need for God's forgiveness was much more obvious. If we cannot recognize our own need, then we will find it impossible to forgive others. But if we can accept that even the best of us only approach God as humble, needy sinners, then forgiveness is the natural response, a genuine, brotherly, sisterly acknowledgement of our basic human condition. Such forgiveness is the act that makes us family, one family sharing one common prayer, our Father. So, finally, we forgive because we are forgiven. It is a way of life, no less, not just an occasional need of generosity. The Christian is forgiving per se by definition. God does not change from rage to love the moment we repent. God is ever-loving, eternally forgiving, only waiting for us to tear down the walls we erected and let us and let the streams of mercy flow into and through us to others. Forgiveness is a way of life. In his book, Last Innocent Blood Be Shed, author Philip Halley tells of the French village of Le Chambon, which rescued thousands of Jewish refugees during World War II. The local pastor, André Trom, had been the initiator, organizer, and spiritual strength of the resistance until finally, one night in April 1943, a knock came on the parsonage door. It was the police with a warrant for the pastor's arrest. In those days, an almost a certain sentence to concentration camp and death. Swiftly, the refugees in the house were hidden, and then they let them in. The pastor was out on calls, but when he returned, he simply picked up a suitcase already packed for this moment and prepared to leave. But dinner was on the table. Madame Trom invited the two policemen to share the meal. Holly writes, later friends would say to her, how could you bring yourself to sit down and eat with these men who were there to take your husband away, perhaps to his death? How could you be so forgiving, so decent to them? To such questions, she always gave the same answer. What are you talking about? It was dinner time. They were standing in my way. We were all hungry. The food was ready. What do you mean by such foolish words as forgiving and decent? They sat down, the four Trom children staring at the police with great staring eyes. Major Silvani, the officer in charge, did not have the heart to touch his food. During the meal, parishioners kept coming in to say goodbye to their pastor, bringing small gifts of treasured items for the camp, like candles, warm socks, and a huge sausage. By the time they had to leave, the two officers were weeping. Then Madame Trom wondered where her husband might get matches to light his candles. And Silvani, the officer himself, presented him a box, saying, I'll tell this story later. Yes, I will keep it alive. And so he did. Forgiveness is a way of life, not heroic effort. No great moral sacrifice or achievement. We were hungry, the food was ready, so we ate. There's a kindness in God's justice, which is more than liberty. For the love of God is broader than the measure of our minds. And the heart of the eternal is most wonderfully kind. Let us remember this each time we pray, forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Amen. Amen. And let us sing, just as I am, without one plea. Please receive the benediction. May the Lord of mercy receive you as you are. May the Lord of grace open your heart to accept his forgiveness. May the Lord of strength grow you in courage to share the love you received. In the name of God, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a wonderful, blessed week, and bye.